Hello students, and welcome in the online session of class 9th science. Chapter 2 is Matter Around Us Pure. This is the second video of this lesson. Let us see what topics we are going to cover today. Mixtures, types of mixtures, properties of mixtures, difference between the types of mixtures, then the two types of changes, that is physical and chemical change, then difference between physical and chemical change, and finally, the solutions and its types. So let's start with the first topic today, that is mixtures. Students, we have studied that matter is divided into two categories. One is pure substances and the other one is the impure substances or the mixtures. So pure substances we have done in the last session. Now today we are going to start the impure substances or the mixtures. So a mixture is a material which consists of two or more pure substances which are not chemically combined but are physically mixed in any proportion. So what we have learned by this definition is that two or more pure substances, when mixed together, they form the mixtures. Okay, and now what can be those pure substances? Those pure substances can be elements or compounds. So when two or more elements or when two or more compounds are mixed together, they form a mixture. Okay, but in a mixture, those components are not chemically combined. Means the two or more pure substances which you are mixing, they will not react with each other, but they are mixed physically. Means they will only live together, they will only remain together, but they will not show any kind of reaction. Okay, and such type of material which is formed after combining two or more pure substances, that is called a mixture. Okay, so you have to remember that in a mixture, the components of the mixture are not chemically combined. There is no chemical reaction between them, but they only live physically with each other. They are mixed physically with each other in any proportion. Okay, because mixtures do not have a fixed composition, they have a variable composition. So the amount or the ratio of the components can be changed. Fine. So the definition could be, again I'll just read for you to understand, that a mixture is a material which consists of two or more pure substances which are not chemically combined but physically mixed with each other in any proportion. Okay, so proportion can change. So let us see the example for mixtures here. So the example here I have described is air. Okay, now air is not a pure substance. Air which is present around us in the atmosphere is not a pure substance, but air is a mixture of gases. Okay, we all know what type of gases are present in the air. Okay, so you have oxygen, carbon dioxide, nitrogen, argon, vapors, dust particles, and many other things are included in trace amounts in the air. So we cannot say that air is a pure substance. Okay, air is a combination of many type of gases. Fine. So air is simply a mixture of gases, and in this mixture the different gases present are in different proportions. Okay, like we know that nitrogen present is 78%, oxygen present is 21%, carbon dioxide present is 0.03%. fine, and 0.1 and other percentage is of the other gases and dust particles which is present in the air. So this proportion is variable. Fine. Now milk is also a mixture of water, fats and proteins. Okay, milk is also a mixture. Now what is present in this mixture? Water is present, fats are present, proteins are present. So milk is also a mixture. Fine. So these are some of the examples of mixtures. But remember that the components of mixtures are not chemically combined. They are only present physically in any of the proportions. Okay. Now here you can see in the diagram many of the mixtures are shown. Okay. Now here you can see a soup in which many of the vegetables are added. Here you can see different colors, jellies are mixed together. Fine. So these are some of the examples of the mixtures. Now let's move on to the next slide and see the types of mixtures. So mixtures are of two types. One is heterogeneous mixture and the other one is the homogeneous mixture. Fine. Now here homogeneous means same. okay, and hetero means different. Fine. So how can we define homogeneous? That in the homogeneous mixtures, you cannot see the different parts of the mixture. Okay, that means when the mixture is formed, they all mix together, they all combine together in such a way that the different components of the mixture are not seen to us. They are not visible differently. Okay, it becomes, they mix so thoroughly with each other that it becomes a single solution, a single mixture. Fine. So we cannot see the different parts of the mixture. Whereas in case of heterogeneous, you can see the different parts of the mixture easily. So in hetero means different, means all the components can be differently seen. Fine. They do not mix very uniformly with each other, but they can be seen in different phases. Okay. So these two are the types of mixtures, homogeneous and heterogeneous. Now, let's see first the homogeneous in detail. So a mixture in which all the components are uniformly mixed. Fine. Uniform means same amount of components will be present in every part of the mixture. Fine. Like in school, you all wear dresses, uniforms you wear. Okay, so you all look very similar. Whole school looks very similar because of the dress of the students. So this is called uniformity, similarity. Fine. So in a mixture, all the components are uniformly mixed. Okay. For example, we have taken here that sugar water. Sugar water is a mixture. So what you have taken? You have taken water as a solvent here and sugar as a solute particle here. Fine. And you are mixing them too. So after mixing sugar and water, this is the mixture formed. Okay. Now this mixture formed here, you cannot see the sugar cubes separately. Okay. So what is the rest of the definition? That there are no boundaries of separation between them. Means the components mix so well with each other that the boundaries of the components cannot be seen separately. Okay. Like here, sugar gets so uniformly mixed with water that you cannot see the sugar cubes or sugar particles in this solution. Even under the microscope also, you cannot see the sugar particles. So they mix so uniformly. Okay. And if you take a sip from the upper side of the mixture or you take a sip from the lower side of the solution, the taste also remains the same. That means the component has mixed very uniformly throughout the solvent. Okay, so a uniform mixture is formed here. So such type of mixtures are called homogeneous mixtures. Even in place of sugar, you can take salt, that will also form a homogeneous mixture, right? But if you take oil in this case, if you add oil in water, fine, if you are adding here, water is there, and if you add here oil, so this will not make a homogeneous mixture because oil will float on the surface of the water. They will not mix, and you can see oil also separately and water also separately. So the boundaries of the components can be seen differently. So that will be an heterogeneous mixture, not homogeneous. Okay. So what you have to remember, that in homogeneous mixture, the components are mixed very uniformly and the boundaries of separation between the components cannot be seen. Now, let's move on to the next slide. Heterogeneous mixtures. Okay. Hetero means different. Now, a mixture in which all the components are not thoroughly mixed. Here what has happened, we have mixed the components, but the components will not mix very thoroughly. And there are visible boundaries of separation between them. Means all the components can be seen separately. All the components are visible to us in the mixture, right? Suppose you have made a fruit salad, right? This is the fruit salad, suppose. Okay, so in this, various types of fruits you have cut, right? And all the fruits are visible to you. So such type of mixture where the boundaries of all the components can be seen easily, they are called heterogeneous mixtures. Fine. So these are some of the pictures of heterogeneous mixtures, right? Fruit salad, even vegetable you can see. Okay, these are chickpeas, and here you milk, and something is mixed in the milk. So here also the component which is mixed, you can see here, fine, which is floating upside. So it's a heterogeneous mixture, fine. So again, with the example here, you can see that when we dissolve sugar in water, it becomes a homogeneous mixture, right? Because the boundary of sugars cannot be seen in the mixture. But if you mix sand in water, so what will happen, children? Now sand is not soluble in water, so it will settle down. So now you can see water also, and you can see the sand particles also separately. So it makes a heterogeneous mixture. Okay, so in a heterogeneous mixture, we can distinguish all the components. All the components are seen separately. Okay, such type of mixture is called heterogeneous mixture. Now, let us discuss about the properties of mixtures. So, a mixture may be homogeneous or heterogeneous. So, now only we have learned that a mixture in which the components, they do not combine chemically, but they are only present physically with each other in any proportion. So, that's a mixture, fine. Now, the first property of the mixture is that a mixture may be homogeneous or heterogeneous. Okay, the mixture will be either homogeneous, means all the components will mix very thoroughly with each other, or the mixture can be heterogeneous, means the components can be seen separately in the mixture. Now, the second important property of the mixture is the composition of a mixture is variable. This you have to always remember, that composition of a mixture is variable. That means you can take any component in any amount. There is no fixed composition. That is not so that you have to take 20 grams of milk and then 20 grams of almonds in it every time. This is not so. If you want, you can take 1 liter of milk and then you can add 2 almonds in it. If you want to take 2 liters of milk and if you have to add 500 grams almonds in it, that's okay. Fine. So, the mixture, the composition of a mixture is variable. Variable means it can change every time. We can take the components in any ratio we want. Okay. Then, the third property is, a mixture does not have a definite melting or boiling point. Because, why this is so? Why the mixture does not have a definite melting or boiling point? Because the different components which are present in the mixture, they do not react. So, they are present only physically. So, they all show their properties. Fine. There is no new substance formed in case of mixture which have a separate property. But all the components of the mixture, they show their individual properties. And that's why a mixture does not have a definite melting or boiling point, because all the components will have different melting and different boiling points. So a mixture cannot have a definite or fixed melting or boiling point. Okay. Then energy is neither absorbed nor evolved during the formation of a mixture. Whenever you are preparing a mixture, so no energy is required. Or no energy is evolved. Neither the energy is absorbed in the mixture nor the energy is given out in the mixture. You only have to simply mix them. Okay. Then a mixture shows the properties of all the constituents present in it. Fine. Means a mixture shows the properties of all the constituents because the composition is not fixed. Okay. So in a mixture, now suppose this is the mixture in which you have added many of the dry fruits. Okay, you can see here cashew nuts, you can see here almonds, you can see here khajur and rest many more. So now all of these components of the mixture, they have their different properties. And when you will eat this mixture, you will find the taste of each and every component. That means each component is showing its property. So a mixture shows the properties of all the constituents. A mixture does not have its own new property formed. Okay, so it shows the properties of all the components only. Here you can see this one is the mixture of iron and sulfur. Fine, this is a mixture of iron. These black color particles which you can see is iron and plus sulfur. This yellow color is sulfur. Iron is a metal and sulfur is a non-metal. So you can see here we have mixed them in any ratio, so it becomes a mixture. Okay. Now, the components of a mixture can be separated by simple physical methods. Now, the components of a mixture can be separated. Okay. In case of compound formation, in case of compounds, we cannot separate the components of a compound. Once the compound is formed, we cannot separate it physically. But the components of a mixture can be separated by simple physical methods. Like here, if you want, you can use a magnet. In case of iron plus sulfur, you can use a magnet for separation here. So if you bring a magnet near to this mixture, all the iron particles will get stick to the magnet and iron gets separated from sulfur. Here also, if you want, by using hand picking method, you can separate the almonds, you can separate the cashew nuts. So the components of a mixture can be separated by simple physical means. Fine. So these are some of the properties of mixture. Let's have again a look. A mixture may be homogeneous or heterogeneous. The composition of the mixture is not fixed. It is variable. Mixtures does not have a definite melting or boiling point. Energy is neither absorbed nor evolved during the formation of a mixture. And a mixture shows the properties of all its constituent. Okay. Again, here I want to give you one example of lemonade, right? Nimbu pani, sharbat. So in the lemonade, you use water, you use lemon juice, you use sugar, you use salt. So, but when you take a sip of the lemonade, you get the taste of each and every component. You get the taste of sugar also. You get the taste of salt also. You get the taste of lemon juice also. That means a mixture shows the properties of all its constituents. Right, and then the components of a mixture can be separated by using physical methods. Okay, so these are the six properties of mixtures. Now let's move on to the next slide and see the difference between mixtures and compounds. Fine, compounds we have studied in the last session that a compound is formed when the different atoms combine together in a definite ratio. Remember, definite ratio. Like water is formed, water is a compound, H2O. Okay, so they define in a definite ratio by mass, by weight, right? So here we have done that the weight of two hydrogen is 2, means 1 for one hydrogen. Weight of one hydrogen is 1 atomic unit, and weight of another hydrogen is also 1 atomic unit. So here we have two hydrogen atoms, so weight is 2, and oxygen, the weight is 16 atomic mass unit. So if you take the ratio, it comes to 1:8. Means whenever hydrogen and oxygen will combine in the ratio of 1:8, they will always form a water molecule. Okay. Or you can see that whenever hydrogen combines with one oxygen, they will always form water. So a compound is formed when the elements or when the atoms combine in a fixed ratio. Okay. So let's see the difference now. So in a compound, the first point is that only that composition of elements present in a compound is fixed. Fine. Elements or the components of a compound, they always mix together in a fixed ratio. Okay, this is very important point about compounds. The composition of elements present in a compound is fixed. Elements will always combine in a fixed ratio to form the compounds. Whereas in mixtures, the composition of elements present in a mixture is not fixed. Okay, we are saying that when two or more pure substances, or you can say when two or more elements or compounds are mixed together, they make the mixtures. So, but the composition is not fixed. You can take the elements in any ratio. If you want to take 2 atoms, you can take 2. If you want 10 atoms, you can take 10. So that composition is not fixed. Okay. Then in compound, the properties of a compound are different from those of its elements. Very important point, children, here, that when a compound is formed, the compound has its new properties. Okay. Suppose, now hydrogen is a gas. We all know that hydrogen is a gas, right? And oxygen is also a gas. Both are gaseous. Okay. Hydrogen has some different properties. Oxygen has some different properties. Oxygen is used for combustion, for burning, right? But when these two combine in 1:8 ratio, they will form H2O, right? So what I want to say is that the properties of hydrogen different, the properties of oxygen different, but when a new substance is formed, this compound is formed, then this compound has totally different properties from hydrogen and oxygen. Okay, totally different. Oxygen is used for burning, but water is used to stop burning. So here the properties are totally different. Fine. So the properties of a compound are different from those of its elements. Okay, component elements have different properties, but the compound formed has its different properties. Whereas in case of mixture, a mixture shows the properties of all its constituent elements. Now only we have discussed that whatever elements or compounds are present in the mixture, they all show their properties. Okay, now in case of compounds, its constituents can be separated by chemical methods only. If you want to separate the components of a compound in water, suppose if I want to separate hydrogen and oxygen, then physically I cannot do this. Physically, by any of the methods, it is not possible. But using some chemical reactions or using some chemical methods, it can be possible. Whereas in mixture, its components can be separated by physical methods only. Okay, physical methods means like hand picking, then by sublimation, evaporation, condensation, okay, these can be possible. Then compound is always homogeneous, okay, a compound is homogeneous substance. Whereas mixtures can be homogeneous as well as mixtures can be heterogeneous also. So these are the most important four points of difference between compound and mixtures. So you have to remember this. If you want to note them out, I used to give you the PPT links also. From there you can write your notes also. And as such, after the lesson completion, I am sending you the notes. But sometimes in the slides, if you found something very important, you can just note it down. Okay. Slides link is always given when I send you the link of the video. So from there, presentation slides link is given. So if you click that, you'll get the PPTs also. Now let's move on to the next slide, that is physical and chemical changes. So this topic you have studied in your lower classes also, that changes, there are many changes around us which we sometimes we observe and sometimes we don't. So those changes which are present around us, they can be grouped into two types. One is physical and the other one is chemical changes. Okay, so physical changes are those in which only the physical properties of the substance change, right? Physical changes means only the physical properties of the substance change. Now, physical means the state can be changed, color can be changed, size can be changed. Means whatever we can see from outside is a physical property. Okay, its state, its color, its texture. If that changes, then it's a chemical change. And here another important thing is that no new substance is formed in case of physical change. Okay, only physical properties are changing, but no new substance is formed. So such a change is called physical change. Like for example, here you can see melting of ice, right? If ice melts, ice is the solid form of water. So if ice melts, it forms liquid water, but water is water only. Okay, formula for the water molecules present in ice is also H2O, and formula for the water molecules present in liquid form is also H2O. So there is no new substance formation. So this type of change is called physical change. Here only state is changing from solid to liquid. Then here you can see the chopping of the wood. If any wood piece is chopped, then a bigger piece gets cut into two smaller pieces. But this part is also wood and this part is also wood. No new substance is formed in the case, right? Then here third one is, we are just cutting the paper pieces, okay? So paper, first it was in larger size, now it is in very small size, but there is no new substance formed. This is also paper, and these smaller pieces are also of paper only. Here you can see mixing of white color and green color balls, right? So this is what a physical change, because there is no new substance is formed here. We can separate the white balls again and green balls again from this mixture. So it's only a physical change. Then breaking of glass is also a physical change. If a glass is broken, then a larger piece gets into very small pieces. But there is no new substance formed. Smaller one is also glass, and previous one was also glass only. So these are some examples of physical changes. Now let's see what are chemical changes. The changes in which a new substance is formed, they are called chemical changes. Okay, so any change in which a new substance is formed is chemical. And always remember that physical changes are generally reversible. Okay, these are reversible changes. They can also be called as reversible changes, because in these changes we can get back the original substance, right? Like melting of ice. So if ice melts, we can again make the ice by freezing it. Okay, so we can get back the original substance, fine. Whereas in chemical substance, once a new substance is formed, it is very difficult to get the original substance. Like here is burning of wood. Once the wood is burned, this wood turns into ash. Okay, now ash formed is a very new substance. It has different properties than wood. So once a new substance is formed, this change cannot be reversed. Okay. Now you can see a rotting banana. If the banana peel is rot, destroyed, okay, then what happens? This change cannot be reversed now, because once it is rotten, we cannot make it fresh. So this is a new reaction which has happened in the peel of the banana, and we cannot make it into fresh one. So this is also a chemical change. Okay, here this is the picture for reaction between vinegar and baking soda. Okay, acid and baking soda is a base. So you can see here, once they are mixed, then a salt is formed. Whenever an acid and base react, they form salt. So once a salt is formed, now salt is a new substance. So again, we cannot get back the vinegar and the baking soda. Okay, and these are the firecrackers which are burned during Diwali or any of the celebration. So once the firecrackers are burned, reaction has occurred, heat and light energy is produced. So it's an irreversible change. Okay, then we cannot reverse it. So it's again a chemical change. A new substance is formed in these cases. Now, let us see the difference between physical and chemical change. So three main points you have to remember about it, that physical changes are mostly reversible. Okay, not every time, but generally and mostly the physical changes are reversible. Means they can be reversed back. Okay, chemical changes are not reversible. Once the chemical change has occurred, it cannot be reversed back. Then in physical, no new substance is formed, whereas in chemical change, a new substance is formed. In physical, the substance retains its chemical properties. Because here no new substance is formed, so no new property. The original substance will retain its chemical properties, same properties. Like if a glass is broken, whatever is the property of the bigger glass, the smaller glasses, glass pieces have the same properties. So the substance retain its chemical properties. Whereas in case of chemical change, the new substance which is formed has different properties from the original ones. Because like wood is burned, so wood has some different properties. But the ash which is formed after burning of wood has some different properties. Okay. So this is the difference between physical and chemical change. Now next important topic here is that is solutions. Fine. So solution comes under the category of homogeneous mixtures. Right, it's a type of homogeneous mixtures. So homogeneous mixtures, we have studied that in this, the components of the mixture, they mix very thoroughly, uniformly they mix. So solutions are the homogeneous mixtures of two or more chemically non-reacting substances whose composition may be varied within limits. Okay, so what happened in solution, children? Solution is a homogeneous mixture. Means whenever you are mixing two or more components for making a mixture or for making a solution, then they mix very homogeneically. Means they mix very uniformly. Okay, but both the components are non-reacting. Okay, now this is a property of mixture, that components do not react chemically, right? So here we are taking non-reacting substances and their composition can be varied. So these rest of the definition part is of mixture only. Okay, that solution is the homogeneous mixture in which two or more components, whatever we are taking, they do not mix chemically and their composition also changes. So such type of solution, such type of mixtures are called solutions, right? Now here two things you have to remember, that the component should be non-reacting. Fine. In solutions, we have to remember that all the components which you are choosing, they should be non-reacting. They should not react with each other. And second one is that mixture should be homogeneous. Mixture form should be homogeneous. So these two are the qualities of the solutions, that the components are non-reacting and mixtures are homogeneous. Fine. Now, so example here is again of lemonade. Lemonade is a solution, right? Solution how? Because you can see here that the mixture formed is homogeneous. You cannot see the boundaries of the components separately. So it's homogeneous. Fine. So we use sugar, salt, lemon juice and water is used to make the lemonade. Okay, nimbu pani. Now these components do not react with each other. Nothing of them are reacting with each other. And everyone shows its taste in the lemonade. When you drink a sip, you'll get the taste of sugar, salt, lemon juice, water, everything. So all of them mix so thoroughly that cannot be seen under a microscope also. They mix so well here that you cannot see them separately in the solution. Okay, so such type of mixtures, they are called solutions. Now solutions are sometimes called the true solutions. True solutions and solution is the same thing. So solutions are also called the true solutions, as the components mix so thoroughly that we cannot distinguish them from each other. Okay, that's why they are called true solutions, because components mix so well that they cannot be even separated. They cannot be seen separately using a microscope also. Okay. So this is all about solutions. Now let us see aqueous and non-aqueous solutions. These words you can, these terms you will find everywhere in the chapter also and in your further studies also. So let us discuss what is aqueous and non-aqueous. Whenever there is aqueous word, it means that the solution in which water acts as a solvent. Okay, so in this the solution which is formed using water as a solvent, okay, that is called an aqueous solution. Means you can see here orange, blue, purple shade solutions are there, and they are homogeneous. You cannot see separate components here, but all these solutions are made using water. Means some blue colored powder is mixed in water, so it becomes a blue solution like this. So water is used as a solvent, so it is called an aqueous solution. And a solution in which any other liquid acts as a solvent, means you are not using water for mixing. If suppose any other liquid you are using suppose benzene is a liquid found in the labs. So if you are adding something in benzene, okay, so now benzene is the solvent here. So this solution which will be formed is called non-aqueous solution. Okay, means aqueous word is used for, aqua means water only. So aqueous solution where water is used as a solvent, and non-aqueous means where other than water some solvent is used. They are called non-aqueous solutions. Fine. Now next one is components of a solution. Now let us see how the solution is formed. Components of the solution. So we are taking here binary solutions. Binary solution means bi means two. So here we are choosing only two components, right? We are choosing only two components. So a solution having only two components, it is called a binary solution. So in a binary solution, the component which is dissolved is called the solute, and the medium in which it is dissolved is called the solvent. This you have studied in lower classes also, that anything which is dissolved is called the solute. Okay, anything which is dissolved is called the solute, and any medium in which we are dissolving, just try to find the difference here. Anything which is dissolved is the solute, and anything or any medium in which we are dissolving is called the solvent. And in majority of the solutions, water is used as the solvent because water is a universal solvent. Water has the capacity to dissolve majority of the substances. Okay, so when you mix the solute and solvent, a solution is formed. So a solution, a water solution is made up of, students, a solution is made up of a solute and a solvent. These are the two components of the solution. Whenever there is a solution, so there will be definitely one solvent and one solute. Okay, so any medium which is dissolved is the solute, and in which we are dissolving is the solvent, right? Now solvent can be solid, liquid or gas, and solute can also be solid, liquid or gas. Fine. So in other definitions, you can say that the component which is present in small amount is called the solute. Anything out of the two which is present in small amount could be the solute, and the component which is present in large amount is called the solvent. This can also be one of the definitions. Okay. Now, next is the types of solutions. Now, solutions are of three types: solid solutions, liquid solutions, and gaseous solutions. Okay. So, what are the three types of solutions? Solid solution, liquid solution, and gaseous solution. Now, remember that in solid solution, solids act as a solvent, means any solvent which we are taking in which the solute will be solved, that will be a solid. So if the solvent used is solid, then such type of solutions are called solid solutions. If the solvent is liquid, then the solution formed is called liquid solutions. And if the solvent is gas, then they are called gaseous solutions. Okay, now here you have seen that there is one solvent, one solute, and it forms a solution. So we are talking that if the solvent is solid, then it is solid solutions. If the solvent is liquid, then it is liquid solution. If the solvent is gas, then the solution is gaseous solutions. Okay, so here are some diagrams for you. Now the first one is a solid solution, right? Now you can see this green one is the solvent. Why we are calling it solvent? Because you can see more green atoms here than the blue ones. So the one which is present in more quantity is the solvent, right? So solvent is this green one, and we have added here some blue color solid atoms here also. So this blue color, they are solute. Okay, so when, now this is solid in solid solution, solid mixed in solid. This is an example of solid mixed in solid. Okay, now here you can see that two liquids are mixing. So solvent is also liquid and solute is also liquid. Here you can see that gas, means the smoke, is mixing in air. That means solvent is also gas, and the solute which is mixing is also in the gaseous form. Okay, but this is also always not the case. Let us try and find out some more cases about this. Okay, so we have seen that three types of solutions are there: solid solutions, liquid solutions, and gaseous solutions. Fine. So let us start from solid solutions first. So in the solvent part, you can see here, then it's solid solutions. The solvent is always solid. So this in the definition we have seen that whenever the solvent is solid, the solution formed is called solid solutions. But solute can be solid, liquid, or gas. Okay. So let's see the examples of each one of them. Now, if you see, if the solvent is also solid and solute is also solid, means solid and solid, then you can give the example of copper dissolved in gold. Copper dissolved in gold. That means gold is the solvent and copper is the solute. Because gold is dissolving copper in it. We are dissolving copper in small amount in large amounts of gold. Okay, so copper dissolved in gold. This is example of solid in solid. Solvent is also solvent is gold here and solute is copper here. So this is solid mixed in solid. Okay, then let us see when liquid mixed in solid. Okay, so amalgam of mercury. Mercury, we have discussed that mercury is the metal which is in liquid form at room temperature, right? So when mercury is mixed with sodium, now sodium is solid. So what we are doing, we are mixing a liquid in a solid. A liquid in a solid. So this is an example of solid solutions in which a liquid is mixed in solid. Okay, then third one is when a gas mixed in solid. So here you can see solution of hydrogen in palladium. Palladium is a metal which is a solid and hydrogen is a gas, right? So when hydrogen gas mixed with palladium, so palladium surface, what it does, it absorbs the hydrogen gas on its surface. So this becomes a gas in solid solution, right? Students, you have to learn these examples because these questions come in exam. Give examples of this solution, right? So you have to learn all these examples, at least two or one example of each one of them. Then now let us come to liquid solutions. So in the liquid solution, definitely the solvent will be a liquid. Now see, first solid dissolved in liquid. Here you can give many of the examples, right? Glucose dissolved in water, salt dissolved in water, sugar dissolved in water, and like this. Then liquid in liquid also you can give many examples. Ethanol dissolved in water, right? Ethanol dissolved in water, or you can say milk dissolved in water. Okay, then oil dissolved in water, honey dissolved in water. So many of the examples you can give. Then gas dissolved in liquid. Now oxygen dissolved in water. In water, oxygen when dissolved, it is already dissolved only. So this is an example of gas dissolved in liquid. Then next one is gaseous solution in which the solvent is a gas. So let us see first one, that when solid is dissolved in gas, right? So you know camphor, students, camphor is kapoor. Okay, so we burn it for doing puja and all. It's a white colored solid bar like piece, right? So camphor, kapoor, in Marathi I think it is kapoor. So camphor in nitrogen gas, right? So when the camphor is burned, it directly change into gaseous form. So what happens now, this camphor is a solid, so when it is burned, it goes in the air, right? So that means solid and gas. So camphor when dissolved in nitrogen gas, it becomes a gaseous solution, right? Then liquid and gas. So liquid is chloroform. Chloroform is liquid. When it is mixed with nitrogen gas, so it becomes a gaseous solution. Then gas in gas is mixture of oxygen and nitrogen gases. Okay, like this. So they are some of the examples of many of the solutions. Now in your textbooks also you will find the table in which many of the examples are given. So students, you have to learn the examples because one of the question definitely comes on this part to give examples, right? Now which is the solute, which is the solvent, this you have to also identify from the given example. Such type of questions also come. Sometimes examples will be given and you will be asked to separate the solute and the solvent, which is the solute and which is the solvent in the case. Okay, so you have a table given in your textbooks also which you can refer to. Fine. So this was the last topic of today's video session, types of solution. Let's see what else we have done today in the summary part. So we have done mixtures, types of mixtures, properties of mixtures, difference between types of mixtures, then changes, difference between the changes, and solutions and its types. So I hope the concepts are clear to you. If any doubt, please feel free to ask anytime, right? And do complete your notebooks. So we'll meet in the next session. Till then, everyone stay home and stay safe.